Hi again, everyone. Welcome back to our tutorials. Today, we are going to do the last tutorial for the Introduction to Research Methods unit. Any additional tutorials will be related to maybe essay format and then argumentative essays. Okay, so this is it for the basics of research methods. So today we're going to look at two things, actually. They're not quite related, but they are related to help you kind of understand maybe internal citations, hopefully. So I'm going to discuss with you introduction paragraph form. I'm going to give you an example of an introduction paragraph that I wrote based on the same thesis statement that you know of from the previous tutorials. And then I'm going to talk to you about internal citations and just kind of give you an example. Okay? So, again, we're talking about internal citations. That's the main point of today. Now, for internal citations, the style that we are using is MLA. Okay? MLA, Modern Language Association. So there are other forms of internal citations that will look different. So if you look up just internal citations, you're going to find a lot of different responses because there are different formats. So you need to make sure it's specific, MLA. Now for MLA, we also call them parenthetical citations. And parenthetical should sound familiar, should sound like another word. So why do we also call them parenthetical citations? Well, because all of the internal citations for MLA format, they are all in parentheses. Okay, so of course you know what parentheses are. They look like this. Okay, so everything is in parentheses at the end of the sentence or paragraph that you're paraphrasing or using a direct quote. Okay, so follow along with me. So before we start talking about internal citations, I just want to do a quick review about introduction paragraphs. I know that the introduction has been a little bit difficult for some of you. The conclusion, I think most of you understand the point, whether you wrote a, effective conclusion or not, most of you understand it. The introduction still gives you some problems, and I know that because of looking at your essays. Now, as you can see from my introduction, it's a little long, right? Well, yes, your introduction paragraph can be long. And that is, of course, for more advanced writers. Your introduction paragraph doesn't have to be 3 or 4 sentences. It can still be concise and a little bit longer because I'm not dedicating any specific paragraphs to background information. This is the argumentative essay. Most of the time for argumentative essays, you're going to put any history or any explanation of background in your introduction paragraph because you just want to be brief on the issue. This is not technically a research paper, so if the reader wants more information on the topic, then he or she should actually go and consult external sources. However, like I said before, if you feel like, no, I really need to explain this topic to my reader, I really got to give them a thorough background, that's your choice as the writer. You can do that if you want to, but it's not necessary for argumentative essay. So I took a couple of sentences to dedicate that in my introduction paragraph. I'm going to adjust my mic a little bit, make sure you guys can hear me. Now, I color-coded it for you. As you can see, in order to practice good form, because that's what I tell you to do, I put my header. Again, your header can be right-aligned. Most MLA format essays, you will see it's actually left-aligned for the header, like this, on the left side. And then at the top of the page, actually in the header, you'll see this lovely page numbering here, okay? So you can model that. At this point, I'm focusing on your essay. So even though, yes, your format has to be correct, and I expect that, I'm not going to spend too much time on that. So left or right, whatever, okay? And then you can see my title here, and I called it The COVID-19 Pandemic Helping the Environment, okay? This is an argumentative essay, and I definitely want to attract people to reading my opinion. So this is not too long of a title. This is a good length. All right. Now, if I had just written the COVID-19 pandemic and the environment, it's a little vague, right? So I went ahead and added helping. Now you will see in green, I have the hook. The Earth has been suffering from the negative effects of climate change for decades now, comma, and in the past 2 years, comma, scientists have been sounding the alarm that drastic changes need to be made in order to save the world. Yes, your hook can be a compound sentence. It can be. I could have made that very short if I wanted to. I could have said the Earth has been suffering from the negative effects of climate change. I would have gotten their attention, yes, but I feel like for this type of essay, I need to be as specific as possible. Why? Because we're arguing our opinion, okay? So in this tutorial, you're not only getting some information about an introduction paragraph and internal citations, but I'm still teaching you about argumentative essays in general before we officially get to the unit. So by the time we get to the unit, you should understand argumentative essays. So I want to be specific because I'm not an expert in climate change. I'm not a scientist myself, well, social scientist, but not, scientists like, environmental scientists. So I really need to be specific with what I'm talking about, especially when we're talking about controversial topics, because this would be considered controversial. We want to make sure that we're specific because we can end up maybe offending somebody in the audience, or if we're not careful, we could write something that is actually not true. All right, so that's my hook. All right, now you'll notice, again, the second sentence of your introduction should answer the hook, and I've answered it. So why is this important? We can vaguely say, why is this important? Or we can say, why have scientists been sounding the alarm that drastic changes need to be made in order to save the world? So why? And I've answered my hook. They have predicted that the planet is facing irreversible damage by 2030, and humanity's existence is at stake. It's important for you to answer your hook. It's important to have that transition from your hook before, you get into anything else, because it just helps with the flow of the paragraph. It helps the reader to understand a little bit more about, what you're talking about. Now, for some of you, what I've taught you is that have your hook and then background and then thesis. I also did teach you about transitions, but that was going over some of your heads with transitions. So I just let you focus on the basic format, which is the hook, background, and also your thesis. A really good introduction paragraph is going to have those transitions. So now I'm transitioning from my hook to my background information by answering my hook. Okay? As if the hook was a question. Okay, and then here's background. However, world leaders, government officials, and policymakers have not moved fast enough. Come 2020 or come 2020, the world faces a global pandemic caused by a coronavirus, now called COVID-19, which has caused a worldwide shutdown of modern human activity. Okay, so I'm giving my readers some background on this issue. So world leaders didn't move fast enough. Okay. This is the reason, why climate change hasn't improved. And then all of a sudden, 2020 comes, and it's like the prayers of the scientists, but the calls of action from the scientists have come true by force. Then you have this pandemic that comes out of nowhere and causes a worldwide shutdown, which causes us to halt human activity. Now, you know, the climate is healing because people have no choice but to stop a lot of harmful activities to the environment. Now, I'm going to transition from the background information, and I'm just going to transition to my thesis. You really want to transition to your thesis. It just makes it flow so much more nicely. So in this case, what you see in blue is the transition to the thesis. It's, when I say transition, it's pretty much all you're doing is preparing the reader for the next part or the next topic. That's all it is. You're just preparing the reader, okay? Otherwise, what you're doing is it's just like all of a sudden you're just moving to a next topic. Imagine talking to your friend about going out, and all of a sudden your friend changes the topic without any warning. That's exactly how it is in an essay. So it's not science. It's not rocket science, guys. It's just preparing your reader for the next part. Because obviously, as you can see from the color coding, this simple introduction paragraph has parts. So I said death, poverty, and economic depression are inevitable. Inevitable means cannot be avoided. You can't get away from it. So death, poverty, and economic depression are inevitable effects of COVID-19. So I've admit that there's definitely a lot of negatives, but there are positive ones happening right now. So excuse the spelling with the T. So I'm preparing my reader to know, to find out, okay, so she's given me all this background. So what's going to happen next? Why am I reading this? So I'm letting the reader know, look, I'm getting ready to tell you about something positive, okay? Now, as a writer, you're going to always correct yourself. So in this part, there are some positive ones. I should probably change that, right? I should change that to there is a positive one happening right now. Why? Because I'm only talking about one positive effect, and that's the environment. I'm not talking about more than one. And so this is what I'm talking about when we're editing essays is logic. So when you go back through your essays, read them carefully and just consider logic. And that is how you, proofread is different. That's how you edit your and revise your essays. Think about the logic of what you're saying, okay? So right there, I just made an edit, a very important edit. Now we're on to the thesis, of course, in red. Thesis, very important. Okay, sorry, I might have cut off just there. But anyway, so COVID-19 is certainly causing the world great strife and stress. However, this global pandemic has come at a time when the environment desperately needed a break, and the COVID-19 global pandemic is significantly helping humanity. Okay, so I want you to notice with my thesis here, I've highlighted is certainly causing, because in my previous, and I've done some of these mistakes on purpose so you can kind of see the process. In the previous thesis, you notice that I wrote has caused the world. Okay, and even though in this case the present perfect is okay, it's still causing the world issues. So actually, present perfect wouldn't be the best grammar choice in that. And those little things are important. Okay, this is also part of the revision stage. You guys are getting a lot of content out of this tutorial. So I changed it to is certainly causing. Okay, and I added an adverb just to kind of add in, you know, the emphasis of argument, right? Now, you'll notice some repetition in my thesis. this global pandemic. Okay, I can take out one of these, I'm sure. So obviously the first one is important. And I can say, instead of repeating myself, which sometimes you guys do, everyone does, but you really want to pay attention to that. I just went ahead and took it out. And COVID-19 is significantly helping humanity. Okay? Now, would this be okay by itself if I had not said global pandemic up there? No. It would not. But now, because I said it once, it's fine. So look, I've already edited my thesis. Okay? Great. All right, so those are the different parts of the introduction paragraph. The only difference for you now is to really try to put those transitions in there. Okay. Now look, background information is still answering your hook as if your hook was a question. It's still doing that, but I added a transition. So this one sentence, most of you guys know from my lessons that this one sentence for you would be your background and move on. Okay? So now that you should be more advanced, you can go on beyond this one sentence that answers your hook as if it is a question, and you can write more in your background information, because you should for an argumentative essay. Okay? And then the next transition is just preparing your reader for what you're going to say in your thesis. All right? So you have this. If you'd like, I can post this on the Facebook group page. You should know by now, and it should be very obvious, that none of you can use my topic for your essay. I was going to make that clear anyway in your argumentative essay instructions, but in case you thought, oh, this is a great topic, I'm going to use this. Yes, yeah, sorry, I took it, so you can't do it. Sorry. You can't write about COVID-19 and climate change at all. So this can be posted just for your reference later on, but you can't use it for yourself. Nice try. Okay, so now you'll notice an important note. Now I am going to transition in talking about internal citations. Internal citations, they're only going to be in your body paragraph. You do not cite sources in an introduction paragraph. You do not cite sources in a conclusion paragraph. You do not. Okay? So you will never see internal citations in an introduction paragraph or a conclusion paragraph. There's no reason for you to cite a source in your introduction. Those should be your own those should be your own words. And the introduction is not meant for you to give a whole bunch of information, right? You shouldn't be paraphrasing anything in your introduction. Even if you use a statistic, people can memorize statistics. So no citing sources in the introduction. Your conclusion should not present new information anyway. So for sure, absolutely no citations should be in your conclusion. Citations are only important for the body paragraphs, the meat of your essay. So now I'm going to take you through as if I were writing the first body paragraph. Now, look, I have copied and pasted this information from my two different sources. If you forgot from the last tutorial, I'm going to take you through those two. This is my Works Cited page. For demonstration, of course, you should have more for your essay. You should have more than two. You should have at least four or five sources. Okay, I'm just copying and pasting it here for demonstration. You are never to copy and paste anything into your essay. Just, that should be obvious, but you should never do that. This is only for demonstration, and I cannot go back and forth between Google Chrome or Internet Explorer and this in this file. Okay, so now, from my thesis, I've made it clear that I'm going to talk about the positive effects from the global pandemic that is called COVID-19 in terms of the environment and helping humanity. So I'm going to start off my body paragraph with a topic that I think is important to explain to my reader. And your body paragraphs, even in an argumentative essay, must be in logical order. Okay, must make sense. You're not going to talk about, how can I put it? You're not going to talk about something that we typically think of at the end, in the beginning. So in my case, I'm talking about the fact that the environment has not had a break from heavy human activity since the Industrial Revolution. The Industrial Revolution started in the 1800s. Why would I talk about this topic in my third body paragraph, right? That doesn't make sense, because I need to go from logic, I need to go from the past to the present, right? So that's how I'm doing that. And that's how you should think of your logic. So anyway, so this is my topic sentence for my first body paragraph. If that's not clear, I'll write this here. You know good and well that you don't write this in the actual essay. You don't do that. That's just for demonstration purposes. So this is my first body paragraph, and this is my topic sentence. The environment has not had a break since the Industrial Revolution, which the COVID-19 pandemic has allowed for the Earth. So in this body paragraph, I need to prove or support this statement that I've made. I've made this bold statement, which is true. It is true, but I still have to prove it. I have to go through and explain myself. So now everything that's in my support needs to be related to prove that, you know, human activity has just been going crazy, right? So, and it's recently halted because of the pandemic. So I can go in different ways with this. I can pretty much start talking about the Industrial Revolution if I want to, and how it's polluted the planet, but that's pretty much a waste of time. Right? I have a specific focus, and that is the COVID-19. You do want to assume that your audience is ignorant, but not so ignorant that you are going to get off topic. Okay? So I'm going to start it this way, and I'm going to write a few sentences and incorporate internal citations, because that's the point of this lesson. But it is also for you to see how and why you use internal citations. So taking into account my topic sentence, let's think of another follow-up sentence. And for purposes of this lesson, I'm going to use two sources back-to-back, okay? I'm going to paraphrase and add to some information from my first source, which is EP Online. Okay, and then I'm going to use the second source, and I am very sorry. The second source is the UN News Agency. All right, so let's see. The environment has not had a break since the Industrial Revolution, which the COVID-19 pandemic has allowed for the Earth. Okay, so let's say I've gone through some of my sources, and I need some help, and I want to use some information from my first source, and I want to paraphrase. I'm going to paraphrase this paragraph. You can take a moment to look at it. So entire cities have shut down, trains and airfare have all but nearly stopped, public spaces are shut down, concerts canceled. Okay. So much of life has stopped, the world, and as much as the world's output of greenhouse gases. I cannot obviously copy and paste that, and I should not. Paraphrasing is not for you to like take the same sentence and just change a couple of words either. You really want to change it around. So I'm going to take from it and add to it. So countries have shut down various aspects of their economic activities, such as manufacturing, public transportation. Let's see, small businesses. Public transportation. Okay, so for parallelism, let's do it this way. Airports, small businesses. And even petroleum production, why not? Okay, even though it's not stated specifically in the paragraph, that's fine. We could interpret it. And that's also part of you paraphrasing and using sources. So much of life has come to a stop, as much of the world's output of greenhouse gases. We know that petroleum production is a major component to pollution and greenhouse gases. So this is something that I can analyze and I can get from that statement. So I'm not, as we would say, putting words in their mouth, because you don't want to do that either. You don't want to interpret your source incorrectly, say something that they haven't said. But in this case, they have said it, because I can interpret it that way, because that's what it means, right? So I can add to their statement. Okay. Now, I've paraphrased that, and I've used this source, and I also want to show my professor that I know how to correctly use sources, and I have backup for my statements, not just my professor, but my audience in general, okay? So now, actually, I'm going to use an internal citation, all right? I've decided to use an internal citation. Now, when you use the internal citation, you start with your parentheses. And inside that citation, you are either going to put the corporate author, excuse me, my voice is cracking. You're either going to put the corporate author or the actual human author or authors there. Only if there are no authors would you put the name of the article. And we'll go over situations like that after this, okay? In my case, I have a corporate author. I chose to use a corporate author. There's no human author, but I chose the organization, which is, what did I say, EP or Environmental Protection, EP Online. EP Online. Whatever is in your works cited, whatever is the first part of your works cited, which is always going to be the author, the corporate author, or in cases that there are no authors, the title. You're always going to use whatever is the first part of your works cited in your internal citation. Always. So here I've put EP Online. So I can't go up here and write something different. I can't put environmental protection. I cannot do that because that's not the first part of my citation. I have to write EP Online. And it's not the title of anything, it's the corporate author. So I don't need to put any quotations. Okay, I don't need to put it in italic. I'm just going to type EP Online. Close my parentheses, period. Bam, that's it. That's it, guys. Of course, with your indentation. That's it. That's literally an internal citation. Okay, now let me give you an example when you are quoting. So I paraphrase. Now I want to use a direct quote from my source to like really put case in point, to really round out what I just, what I'm trying to say. Okay, here's the thing about quotes. It's very important. When you use direct quotes, number one, you must cite your source. okay, internally, is what we're doing right now. Do not use too many quotes, okay? If the information can be paraphrased, it is always better to paraphrase it then, okay? You want to use quotes when, like I said, you really want to put case in point. You want to really use a strong quote. Okay, so what I'm going to use, to me, I think it is, a strong quote, right? And I have a strong source. I have the United Nations. So I'm trying to argue this point, and then using a quote from the United Nations is pretty good, right? Then I would use that direct quote. Also, do not use long quotes at your level. You guys are just starting out, okay? There is no reason for you to use 3, 4, 5, 6 lines of quotes. There's a very special way to actually use long quotes. It's not even in the same way that I'm going to show you, like you just use quotation marks. No. Once your quote is 3 lines, actually, I'm sorry, 4 lines, unless they change it to 3, but as far as I know, when it reaches 4 lines, not sentences, guys, 4 lines, okay? 4 lines. You have to separate it from your paragraph. You have to indent it and separate it from your paragraph, and then, of course, cite it. And you're not doing all that right now, okay? If you give me a long quote in your essay, I'm going to look at you as if, like, you don't know what you're talking about, because it's unnecessary, okay? Paraphrase that information, please. So, in my case, I'm just going to show you the quote because I want you to know how to properly do internal citations, okay? If you want to use quotes in your essay, no more than 2. Like, honestly, you shouldn't have any more than 2, and each of those quotes shouldn't be more than 2 lines. Those will also be instructions on your argumentative essay instructions. It's unnecessary, okay? All right, so here I'm going to use a quote, and I'll tell you another aspect about using quotes as well. So let's quote. Start off with my quotation mark. I'm going to quote from my second source, which is the UN News Agency. Doing a mic adjustment, guys. Okay. Now, of course, you can just go through and copy and paste the quote as long as it's, in your quotation mark, but I'm not going to do that because it's a different format and I don't want to change it. Okay, so the quote that I want to use is the first sentence of this paragraph because it kind of encapsulates everything that I'm saying. So the global coronavirus pandemic, which has already caused unimaginable devastation and hardship, has brought our way of life to an almost complete halt. And I also want to use this because it's in the last part, has brought our way of life to a complete halt. This is the point that I'm trying to make. The environment has not had a break since the Industrial Revolution, and that's because of us. Business as usual. You know, improving society, but at what cost? Those costs have not been considered. Human activity is selfish. We want comfortable lives, and that comes at a cost, which has not been considered. So, this is kind of backing up my point. So, the global coronavirus pandemic, which has already caused Imaginable devastation. If this is annoying you, you can just skip to the next part. Hardship has brought our way of life to an almost complete halt. Okay, notice what I'm going to do here. This is a direct quote, so there's no putting a period here, none of that mess, because we have to cite it. You cannot use a direct quote. Direct quote means that it's exactly what is said in the source, and you put quotation and marks around it. You cannot have a direct quote without your internal citation. Ever, 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 ever. I'm going to put my closing quotation mark, space. I'm going to open my parentheses. Now, I need to make sure that my citation includes the exact name of my source. I chose a corporate author again for my second source. United Nations News Agency. Whatever is here has to be used in my citation. So I can't put here in my citation, UN News Agency. I cannot do that. Okay? UN News Agency. Not for corporate authors and not for human authors. I can't abbreviate. I can't put that. News Agency. Can't do that. Okay? I have to put it exactly as it is there. All right? So now, from the website, if they used the term United Nations News Agency, then I have to put it exactly as it is here and use it up there. Okay? So now I've gone back to where I've copied and pasted from the previous tutorial, and it just says United Nations News. So I can probably just put news instead of agency. So I can adjust my source, as long as it goes, you know, correctly from the website. So, because you don't want your internal citations to be too long. If there's unnecessary words in there, take them out, because you don't want them to be super long. In this case, I have that ability to do that. So, I'm going to use United Nations News. Close my parentheses, period. That's it. But do you notice that for a direct quote, I have to put my quotation mark here? I can't put it here because that's not part of the quote. The internal citation is not a part of the quote, right? So it has to be where the quote actually ends. These are examples of two internal citations. Okay? Now, anytime that you use a direct quote, again, a direct quote being what's exactly said from your source, and which you would tell me by, you know, putting it in quotation marks, which we've done here, you have to explain it, okay? Don't just use a quote and then leave it by itself. That's the worst thing that you can do. You have to explain your quote always. Just like with your hook, you need to answer your hook for your background information. Same thing for a quote. If you use a quote, you have to explain it. So do not use quotes at the end of your body paragraph. Do not use quotes at the end of your body paragraph. This is not the end. It cannot be. I have to explain the quote, always. Again, explain the quote, always. Okay? So now let me put my thinking cap on and think of a sentence. So the global coronavirus pandemic, which has already caused unimaginable devastation and hardship, has brought our way of life to an almost complete halt. So I'm just going to make a point like I did earlier about the point that I'm trying to make. Let's see. Human human selfishness. Has influenced our look what I did. It's easy to do. As long as you know you go back and correct it when you proofread, that's fine. But we do it because we're humans, right? So, of course we're going to say our. Human selfishness has influenced the way business has been performed. Okay. Look, guys, it might not be perfect, but hey, here we go. Human selfishness has influenced the way business has been performed by, you know, pushing the earth to its limits in order to produce more for a better, more comfortable lifestyle. Okay? So that's the case that I'm trying to point. So I'm still not finished with this body paragraph. In my opinion, I'm not. Just to put in point that you have to explain your quote. And when I say explain your quote, that doesn't mean paraphrase your quote. We can read the quote. You don't need to paraphrase it. You need to explain it by pretty much imagining that someone asked you, why are you using this quote? Why is this quote important to you? What's the purpose of this quote here? So you're explaining your opinion in regards to the quote. Okay, so the quote should always help to expand your opinion. Okay, so that's it for internal citations. You also got a little taste of how to start your or how to write your body paragraph. You already know how to start it, but a little bit more about how to write the body paragraph. Also went over with you how to write the introduction in more detail, okay? And also, you know, not to write internal citations in your introduction and conclusion. Okay, so now what I'm going to show you, yes, this tutorial is long and it's unscripted, so excuse me for some pronunciation mistakes or, you know, I'm losing train of my thoughts. Just bear with me, guys. Okay, so from the website that I shared with you on our Facebook group, they have a lot of information about what to do and what not to do for your in-text citations, or as I call them, internal citations, parenthetical citations for MLA. So I'm just going to go over some of the guidelines and rules for you. However, this is something that your professor is not going to always pound in your mind. This is something that you have to memorize, to learn it, I should say, instead of memorize. And then also, if you need help, which you wouldn't be human if you didn't, you have the proper resources that I think you should save on your browser, save in your notes for future classes. So that you can, you know, use it. This is the point of this class. This is me preparing you for the future. So use those resources. So let's go here. I'm going to zoom. Oh, no, that's not going to work. I'm going to zoom this in a little bit so you can see it better. Okay, so we already went over the first part. You're putting your internal citations in parentheses. Okay, it's at the end of the sentence, and you put the period after the last parentheses, as I've already shown you. So for every single different type of medium, print, web, DVD, article, journal, whatever, you're going to have a different you're going to have a different format, because the authors might be different in a different format. It's just going to be different, right? So for all those situations that you might want to ask me, well, what if we don't have an author? What if we have more than one author? You know, those kind of situations, they answer that for you. Trust me, it's already been asked. We already went over that information. So let's go to the next part. Author style means that you know your author, okay, the human author. And also, if you have a corporate author, you know that author. So what this is in the quotation mark, you will add the author's last name, always last name. We never use an author's first name, ever, okay? Now, the only time that you may use an author's first name is if the last name is not posted of that person, which you might want to rethink about using that source, because if that person does not want to use his or her last name, there must be a reason behind it. Like a blog, for example, maybe, you know, the name is just written Susie. Why doesn't Susie want you to know her last name? Okay. Just keep that in mind for your sources. So anyway, so we always use the last name. And when you're talking about hard copies of a source, you usually have page numbers, right? When we come to electronic sources, we don't usually have page numbers. Depending. If it's an electronic book, you still have page numbers. So you should use those page numbers. So let's say you got some information from page 365 of a book by me, Natalie Murray. So you would put Murray 365 in parentheses. And as it has here, you do the same thing. Now, you have different styles. You can also mention the author's last name in your, this is probably, you know, part of a direct quote, or whether you're paraphrasing, you can put the author's last name, and then in parentheses at the end of the sentence, notice the structure there, it has the page number. Of course, if it's more than one page number, you would put, like, for example, 263- let's say 265, okay? Doesn't matter. You just put the dash and then whatever is the last page that you refer to. Okay, so for that part, that's pretty simple. And then the next example, if you don't use the author's name in your actual paraphrase or whatever, then you would just put the author's last name and the page number within the parentheses. Easy. Okay, there's no point of you writing the author's last name and writing it again at the end. There's no point of that. All right, so that's one style, whether it's a hard copy book or whether it is an electronic book, the internal citations will stay the same. You don't cite an entire book, guys. If you're using anything that has pages, you're going to use those page numbers. So if you don't write that down as you're doing research, that's a problem. Make sure you're writing down what page you got that information from, because you don't cite an entire book. That doesn't look good. And when I say cite an entire book, I'm talking about internal citations only, right? You don't just put, you know, let's say it is, you know, it is a book and you use like 10 pages and you just put Woodsworth. And then your work cited, I can see that it's a book. And I'm going to say you cited the entire book. No, you can't do that. All right. So it has to be page numbers. Keep up with those. The next situation is you don't know the author. And as you can see, this is for print sources. Okay. It can be the same for electronic. So what you do is you just use the shortened title of the work. Place the title in quotation marks, of course, if it's an article. And if it's a longer work, like a play, a book, a television show, an entire website, then you would italicize it. Okay? Again, you shouldn't really be citing an entire, you know, book. But if you don't have the author of that book, you really don't have much of a choice, right? Most of the time when we do this with no known author, it's usually a shorter work that we use in quotation marks. So as you can see here, impact of global warming, that might not be the full name, right? Look here, the impact of global warming in North America. We shorten it, okay? Because as long as you use the first 3 to 4 words, then I can go, or the reader can go to your works cited page and still find it easily without you writing the whole title. You know, you don't want to interrupt the flow of your paper by using really long internal citations. Mic check. Okay. Let's see, I'm trying to think of when. So if you don't have an author of a book, okay, and you have to do an internal citation and italicize it, in my opinion, you still need to have page numbers. Okay, that still doesn't change what I said earlier. If you have a book without any type of author, you might want to check your source as well, the credibility of your source. Usually there's some kind of author. Maybe there's a corporate author, like an organization. I mean, I don't know of too many books that don't have authors. So if you find a source like that, you know, you want to throw me a curveball and drive me crazy because you are that student that found that kind of source, then still you want to use those page numbers in your internal citation. Okay? That covers that. Hopefully that is clear for you. The next one is citing authors with same last name. So let's say you find some sources and ironically those authors have the same last name. Okay, and you're like, uh-oh, how do I differentiate between the two? Well, I'm sure they have a first name. So let's see. So sometimes more information is necessary. So in the case that you have two or more authors that have the same last name, then you're going to offer their first initials of the author's first name. Okay, so let's say here we have R. Miller. Let's say it's Richard Miller and Ann Miller, right? So then you can put the first initial of that person's first name, and same thing for her, just to assume that. Okay, if you have that situation, that's how you differentiate. In the case that you have, because I've had this situation too, they have the same last name. They have, of course, different first names, but the first names happen to be, again, they start with the same letter. Okay, let's say I have Richard Miller and Renee Miller. Okay, and then in that case, then you would have to try to hopefully see if they have a middle initial so that you can use their middle name. Okay, it can get a little complicated in those situations, but there are ways to figure that out. All right, so that's that situation I wanted to present with you. Let's say you have a source that has multiple authors. No problem. Most of the time, multiple authors usually consist of like two different authors. So in that case, you just put both authors' last names using and, right? So in this case, we have Best and Marcus. Again, we have the last name of the author, Best Marcus, and we've used it in the paraphrase. So at the end, we can just put the page number. In the case that you don't use the author's last name in your paraphrase, then at the end, okay, this is a completely different style here. At the end, then you put Best and Marcus, the two authors' names using and then the page number. No problem. Okay, easy. And this is how it looks on the works cited page. Okay, so the first author that is mentioned on your source is the first author that you write in your citation. Last name first, first name second, comma, and then you continue that way with first and last name for the rest of the authors. Okay? Now, for a source that you have three or more authors, then what you do is you list only the first author's last name and then replace the additional names with et al. You see here, et al. It's like, that's another way of saying like et cetera, so that I know that there's multiple authors. And if I want to find out who those authors are, I can go down to the Works Cited page and find that information myself. So as you can see, so you can see the example for a source of three or more authors, okay, the last name of the first author and replace the additional with et al. So at the bottom, do you see? According to Frank et al. Okay, and then of course we have the page number. And then again, Frank et al. And then the page number. Notice that for this internal citation, et al. Has a period after it. Okay, has a period after it. Okay, and look at the corresponding works cited. Okay, Frank Caroline et al. Okay, so in this case, they just wrote et al. For the additional authors. You can do that. I mean, I've had sources where I've had three or four authors, and I'll write down all of the authors. Now, if you have a work that has, you know, more than four, just write et al. Okay, but I have, like I said, written down four authors and put it in my works cited. But you don't have to. I used to do it. I think they've also changed the format. We had to do that. But in this case, you can put et al. In your works cited. Of course, in your internal citation, you can write et al. For three or more authors, not for two, guys. Three or more. Okay, so there's other situations and probably other questions in your mind about, like, when do I use internal citation if I don't have, excuse me, guys, how do I write the internal citation if I don't have this and this information? Okay, well, all right, guys. Then you can go ahead and go to the website again, and you can look up all of that information. AlPurdue is a good resource to use. Okay, and also the website that I gave you before, if you forgot, Scriver. Okay, ignore everything else. Scriver.org. Okay, I think it's org, right? Yeah. All right, good. If it's not org, it's com. I'm pretty sure it's org. Okay, guys, so now let's look at the works cited page. You've already seen this. I just want you to see it again so you know what it looks like. I made an edit earlier today, well, a couple of edits. As you can see, they're highlighted, so let me correct that. All right, you saw what I did there. Okay, just hit tab. Okay, I will hit backspace tab, but don't worry about that. Okay, so in the previous example in the previous tutorial, you would have seen, can't speak anymore, that I did this. What did I do? I'm not supposed to write that way. Anyway, there was double quotations here. Okay? Starting quotations. Automatically it does that because I'm not supposed to do that. Okay, gotcha. So anyway, if you look at the previous tutorial, you're going to see extra quotation marks, which is incorrect. When I typed it into the MLA generator, I typed it in there with quotation marks, so it came out that way. You don't have to type in quotation marks when you are putting it into a generator online. It does it for you. So I corrected that. And then also the link was wrong that I put. I put this link as this in the citation as well, so I fixed that. Remember, I recorded all my information, so I had it right there. Okay, so this is how it should look. All right, so So that completes the tutorial. So hopefully that wasn't all over the place for you. I just want to get as much information to you as logically possible. I know I did talk about paragraph structure, and I'll put that in the title that I talked about these different topics, so that if you need to refer back to this tutorial, you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about more than just internal citations. The next tutorial I'm going to do as an extra. The reason why I said forget about it when I was fixing that citation just now is because a lot of you are having format issues, and I think it's maybe lack of knowing what to do in a Word document, or maybe you're having a different, you know, version of Microsoft Word, you know, whatever it is. I'm going to show you how to fix some formatting errors for, you know, standard essay format. I think that is needed for you guys. So that's going to be a focused extra tutorial just showing you how to fix your essay, okay, and different commands that you can do to do that, you know, fairly quickly. So some of you that had the privilege of me actually correcting your format, it didn't take me long because I know how to do it, but B, because, you know, I have those commands that I can fix it well. All right, so enough talking. Again, if you have questions, you can post them on Facebook when I alert you guys of the new tutorials. I'm going to start putting these only on YouTube. If I do another narrated PowerPoint, which I will do at least one, I will put it in all three places, provided that Zagil works. I'll put it everywhere for you. But for tutorials, I'm not putting it on three different places. It's just unnecessary. So check YouTube often for these tutorials. Okay, guys, stay safe. Hope you're doing well. And stay doing well if you are. If you're sick, I'm so sorry. Get better. And I'll talk to you guys later.